joining us at Christchurch Southport. My name's Taps, and I'm here to introduce you to the fourth episode of our current series here at CCS Online. A special welcome if you are new watching us today. We're a Church of England congregation at the heart of Southport, with a heart for Southport. If you don't know us, that's our vision, and we join together here in a bunch of different ways to build community where we can each grow and seek the power of God to bring hope in relevant ways to today's society. We're about putting Jesus at the centre and seeing lives changed, which is exactly what we've got planned for this week's episode. So in a sec, I want to invite you to take a moment to stop and to be still, and to ready your heart and your mind to step further into God's presence, giving him praise with a psalm and praying that you would find the faith and hope to hear him speak to you today through this episode. Then when we're ready, we'll head over live to hear this week's message from our Sunday morning in-person gathering. We'll have some music from some of our worship team and hear some ways you can continue to connect with CCS. But before all that, here's a little bit more of who we are.
Today's reading is from John's Gospel, chapter 17, verses 20 to 25. And if you'd like to follow it on the screen, it's on the screen behind me, but it's also in your Bibles, the blue book in front of you, on page 1085, 1085, if you'd like to. That's great. My prayer, and this is Jesus praying for all believers. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. Are you well?
Oh, the 9:15 did better than that. Are you well?
Yes.
Great. And this, yesterday morning, our kids said there's a Mother's Day and a Father's Day. What happens to the Children's Day? And we told them the obvious answer: every day, the Children's Day, of course. So we are in the middle of this preaching series looking at Jesus' prayers that help us give a key insight into his priorities and therefore our priorities. And this morning, we are looking at one of the last prayers that Jesus prayed on earth and what it teaches us about unity and reconciliation. So let us pray before we start, as Jesus did. Let us do that. Lord, thank you that you are here in this room. Thank you that you are present in the lives of everybody in this room. Thank you that you know each person. Thank you that you love each person. Lord, thank you that you've called us each here on this moment, on this day, to be in your presence. And for some of us, Lord, I know you want to speak this word to their hearts. So I just pray, Lord, that we might be able to hear you. Pray for your Holy Spirit as I speak, your Holy Spirit as we listen. Lord, will you speak? Because your servants desperately need to hear you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There is a date in recent history that is undoubtedly one of the most important dates of all time. It was May 25th, 2005. Istanbul, Champions League final. Liverpool 3-0 down, not just facing defeat, but utter humiliation. Up steps Rafa Benitez to give the speech of his life. No one was there apart from the team. No one knows who he says, but this speech has entered sporting history. In fact, someone has actually written out a whole transcript of apparently what he said, which ended with this terrible line, give yourself a chance to be heroes, lads. We don't know what he said, we don't, but we know what happened next. The greatest sort of comeback in major sporting history, I just got to say it, European champions five times. Six times, of course. And the reason that the last words of a leader or a captain or a manager are so important, these are the words that his people hear as they enter their own particular field of battle. And everything Jesus said was good stuff, of course. Everything he said was good, but some of the most important things he said were in the last 24 hours of his life. He said a lot of stuff then. And one thing he said, one thing he prayed for, is what we're looking at today. And here is his prayer from his passage in John. I pray that all of them may be one, that they may be one as we are one, so that they may be brought to complete unity. And this prayer is utterly remarkable, because let us not forget that it was prayed at the beginning of Jesus' passion. In a few minutes, he was going to be in that Garden of Gethsemane. And as he sat there, he saw before him an experience of such bitter and intense physical and spiritual suffering that he was so deeply distressed by it, but that in a few minutes, he was going to be literally sweating blood. He was in agony of spirit. And in that moment of high intensity and drama for him, when the blood and the sweat and the tears were literally going to be pouring down his face in a matter of minutes, what was he praying for? As he looked forward to the unfolding church, you know, his people's journey of what was going to happen in front of him, what did he pray for his followers? He didn't pray, "Please, Father, let my followers hold to the right teaching on human sexuality." He didn't pray for that. He didn't pray, "Please, Father, let my followers hold to the right line of whether a man or woman should preach in church." He didn't pray for that. He didn't pray, "Let my followers be accurate on when and how the sort of second coming is going to happen and unfold." No, he didn't pray for any of that stuff. He prayed that his people would be united. He prayed for unity. And do you know what? He prayed this because he knew that humans have a predisposition against unity. We are naturally fractious. We naturally seek and want to hold our own way. And if you look across our world and our church today, unity is probably the last word that you think about as you cast your eye over it all. Our world is a torn and battered and fragmented place. Since the end of World War II, nearly 80 years, we've seen over 150 major wars on this planet. In this country, we have more single households, more lonely people, more isolated people, more broken families, more divorce than we have ever had. And how about the church, the people that Jesus, in the agony of spirit, prayed for? How are we doing? Do you know that there are over 22,000 different types of churches in the world today? 22,000. And in our local churches, we know that unity is sometimes the last thing on our minds behind ensuring, if we are honest, our own way is heard and followed. And yet, what did Jesus pray for in the intense and bitter hours before he died? "Jesus, may they be one. Please, Lord, may they be one as we are one." This morning, I just want to talk about two things. The first thing, very briefly. Firstly, what is unity? And then secondly, how do we reclaim it? So first, you know, what is this unity thing anyway? What does it mean? And at its most basic level, it simply means being one, as Jesus prayed. But the problem often with our thinking on this is that most of us confuse unity with uniformity. And uniformity, of course, means everything is identical. And you hear uniformity and you hear school uniform. And you hear school uniform and you think of all the kids wandering around wearing identical stuff. And of course, when we think about this, spiritually speaking, we think unity means everyone's got to wear identical spiritual uniform. We all need to wander around looking identical, and our goal is to eliminate our differences. And there are three problems with this kind of thinking. One, it's not what Jesus had in mind. And secondly, it's not possible anyway. And third, it'd be a bit boring. If all we had was Simon Cowell on our TVs and Justin Bieber on our radios and, you know, roast chicken for dinner, some of us would be happy for a while, but after a while, it wouldn't last. And that's the path of a uniformity, a path of dullness and boredom. But what God had in mind was something much more explosive and much more mind-blowing. And it was this: God wants unity. God wants people to be one despite their differences. The power of unity is not in uniformity, but in handling differences. It's easy to have unity when we're all identical. Everyone's doing that. It's dead easy. It's when we choose unity, choose to be one, choosing costly love, despite the fact that person sitting next to you wears different clothes, sings different songs, thinks some bits of theology are more important than you do, maybe even believes something differently to what you do. As a famous guy, John Wesley, once said, in essentials, unity. In differences, liberty. In all things, charity. I haven't got time to look at the essentials. We have some essentials. I haven't got time to look at them, but read Ephesians 4, verses 1 to 6. It's all there. In essentials, unity. In differences, liberty. In all things, charity. And please, if you hear nothing else this morning about unity, please hear this: unity is not about destroying differences. God loves it, actually. It's about destroying dividing walls. God did not bring harmony to us by getting rid of differences, but by getting rid of barriers between us. It is when we let differences become those barriers that unity is lost. And we know that God values unity in diversity because Jesus prayed, "Let them be one as we are one." And God as Trinity, three in one, is the most beautiful picture of unity and diversity that we have. God as Trinity, three in one, three parts of that Godhead that were not identical at all, but they lived in unity, always looking to the other, glorifying the other, loving the other, existing in difference, but in perfect unity. So that's what unity is. I said I was going to be brief. I want to spend most of my time, though, on the second point, the second question. How do we reclaim it? How do we actually reclaim unity? How do we get it back when it's lost in our churches at large, but in the relationships that we have with other people? Through a wonderful, extraordinary, beautiful word called reconciliation. And you know, there's lots I could say about this fantastic word if I had time, but the first thing I want to say about this is reconciliation is the great work of God. It's what our gospel message hinges on. When Paul speaks about what Jesus died for, what he came to this earth to accomplish, what he rose in glory for, he speaks of it in terms of reconciliation. Jesus came to make peace between God and humankind. And when we talk about living reconciled lives, we mean being utterly being at peace with God and being at peace with each other. It's what Jesus died for. And it says in Ephesians 2:14, "He himself is our peace, who was made to one. He has destroyed that dividing wall of hostility." He keeps on destroying that dividing wall of hostility. If we are followers of Jesus, and if we are the new creation that is spoken of in Colossians 3, then a sign of that is reconciliation. A sign of that is reconciled lives. A sign of that is people who are facing sort of conflict and division, who are constantly looking to restore broken relationship. As one author said, the test of faith in a family, church, or community is not the absence of conflict. It's always going to be there, but the evidence of reconciliation. And you know, but so often the opposite is true. How can that be true? A church that's based on a gospel of reconciliation, that's been given a ministry of reconciliation, it says in the scripture, so often we live broken and unreconciled and ruptured lives. You know, if you went to Berlin in the early 1980s, you would of course be confronted by the Berlin Wall that separated East and West Berlin. If you walked along the northern section of this wall, you would come to an extraordinary sight: a church that was divided by the Berlin Wall. Its front, with a statue of Christ, was in East Berlin. Its other side is in West Berlin. A 10-foot brick wall, the Berlin Wall, runs right through it. A church separated by a brick wall. And do you know what it's called? What its historic name is? The Church of the Reconciliation. And in those early 1980s, it was abandoned. It was empty. A church of the reconciliation, abandoned and empty, with a 10-foot wall running through it. It's a prophetic statement of much of Christ's body, the church, in the day that we live in. And why is that? You can almost hear the cry from heaven, how can this be? How can churches and Christians have brick walls that separate them? How can they live unreconciled lives? And you can hear this cry in Acts 7 when Paul is speaking of Moses, who when he was in Egypt came across two sort of Israelites fighting each other. And Paul said, Moses tried to reconcile them. He used that word. And he said, men, you're brothers. Why are you hurting each other? And there's a guy called Thomas Brooks said in fantastic old-fashioned language, he said, labor mightily for a healing spirit. Discord and division become no Christian. For wolves to hurt lambs is no wonder, but for one lamb to hurt another, this is unnatural and monstrous. The test of faith in family, church, community, the outworking of unity is not the absence of conflict, it's the evidence of reconciliation. If reconciliation is the great work of God, if it's the sign of how we reclaim unity, if it's a sign of new creation, if it's a sign of a person or a people becoming more like Jesus, then how do we respond? You know, what do we make of this? Just three quick points before I end on this. And here's the first one. Reconciliation cannot wait. Reconciliation cannot wait. There was once an author called Gabriel Marquez who wrote a book called Love in the Time of Cholera. And in this book, he talks about a husband and wife who kind of fall out because the husband thinks his wife has misplaced his soap. And he says, I've been bathing for almost a week without soap. And his wife angrily denies it. And they fall out so badly that for 7 months, they sleep in different rooms. And Marquez writes later about them. He says, even when they were old and placid, they were very careful about bringing it up, for their barely healed wounds could begin to bleed again as if they had been inflicted only yesterday. And you know, so many of us fall into a trap of thinking that we don't need to reconcile because either it's not a right time or time is just going to heal it anyway. Let me tell you this, without reconciliation, ruptured relationships never heal. The hurt and anger might diminish, as it did for this couple. It might disappear from your conscious mind, but it is never healed. How often do we hear of stories of families who don't speak for decades because of some conflict or disagreement? Has time healed them? Has time healed the conflicts of nations? Does time heal breakdown in families? No. Without reconciliation, ruptured relationships never heal. Reconciliation cannot wait. And Jesus knew this because he tells us so in his Sermon on the Mount in Matthew, which is Jesus' own kind of sermon about his values, about his sermon outlining what his kingdom, what his people are going to look like, what he hopes they'll look like. He says this in Matthew 5. He says, if you're offering your gift at the altar and there remember that your brother or sister, let's add that, has something against you, leave your gift there. First, go and be reconciled to your brother or sister, then come and offer your gift. Reconciliation cannot wait. You can't even bring your worship before it needs sorting out. In fact, he seems to go further and seems to say that an unreconciled relationship blocks your worship before God. It cannot wait. It cannot wait. Firstly, it cannot wait. And secondly, reconciliation requires courage because it is risky. No one is pretending otherwise. It is risky because even though it only takes one party to rupture a relationship, it takes two to reconcile it. This is where forgiveness and reconciliation are different. We spoke about this a few months ago. You can forgive with no response. You can't be reconciled with no response. It takes two. It's always risky. You're always faced with the possibility of painful failure, of being rebuffed. It always requires courage. In 1492, two really prominent families in Ireland, the Ormonds and the Kildares, were in the middle of a bitter feud. And as this feud grew and grew, it at one point turned into open warfare. And the Earl of Ormond was besieged by the Earl of Kildare. And so he and his family and followers ran into a cathedral, St. Patrick's Cathedral, and he bolted himself into this chapter door with his really thick door. But as the siege wore on, the Earl of Kildare suddenly came to his senses and realized this was crazy. Here are two families worshipping one God in one church, living in one country, trying to kill each other. And so this guy, Kildare, stood outside at this door and he shouted through it. He said, let's stop this, come on out. And the guy on the other side, Ormond, he was pretty skeptical about this, as you can imagine. And so he refused. And so Kildare grabbed a spear and he started stabbing at this door. It must have taken him ages, a really thick door. But he stabbed a big hole in this door. And suddenly he did an absolutely insane thing. He thrust his hand through this door. It was crazy because these were people at war, and any one of those heavily armed men could have just hacked off his arm. And for one moment, no one did anything because it was insane. It was crazy. And then suddenly his hand was grasped at the other side by the Earl of Ormond. He shook his hand and the war was ended. And this ancient door with a hole in it still exists. If you go to Dublin, St. Patrick's Cathedral, you'll see it. It's called the Door of Reconciliation. And can I urge you, my friends, take a risk with reconciliation. There is no greater risk than what Jesus did for you. A risk of your rebuff. If he can do that, you can take it with your brother or sister. Take a risk with reconciliation. Firstly, it cannot wait. Secondly, take a risk. And thirdly, every act of reconciliation is a victory for God's kingdom. Every act of reconciliation is a dagger blow in the heart of our enemy. I helped plant a church called Gateway in Wigan, and church planted for us, I tell you, it was nothing as we thought it would be. It really wasn't. Our lessons in our first 2 years were all about us as relationship and less about mission. We did hardly any mission. It was all about what was happening amongst us. And there were several points in those 2 years where I honestly thought that we would not survive. Our struggle with our relationships was so bitter and so difficult. I didn't know if we would make it. But I remember one particular moment and one particular lesson and one particular sermon that I gave in the midst of this struggle. And this sermon was entitled, Go and Buy a Field. And it happened because at that time, in the midst of this kind of struggle and conflict and broken relationships, I was reading Jeremiah. And there was a remarkable moment in Jeremiah where God's people are being besieged by the might of Babylon. And they are on the verge of being totally destroyed. And their city and land on the edge of utter ruin. And in the middle of the siege, God's word comes to his prophet Jeremiah, and he asks him to go and buy a field. And in that desperate situation where people were fighting for their lives and there was no hope left, when all seems lost, it was a crazy act. It was completely insane. It was bonkers. But in some Bible notes that I got for Jeremiah as I read in preparation for this sermon, it said this about this Jeremiah passage, and I'll just end with it. Christians are called to similar acts of insane hope, signs of God's coming kingdom. Every deed of reconciliation in a divided world is a hopeful sign of our future. Every healing word is a picture of our final healing. Every refusal to act with violence displays a coming peace. Every song of worship is a foretaste of a time where all will bow towards God in love and praise. Every little act of obedience promises a day when his will is done on earth as in heaven. Do not despise a day of small things. Do not suppose that small gestures of insane hope count for nothing. Go and buy a field. Every act of reconciliation is a gesture of insane hope. In a world besieged by Babylon, go and buy a field. Your relationships might feel so difficult, and it feels like you're being besieged by Babylon, that your enemy is too big and your resources too little, that reconciliation might seem so far and so distant. But God is asking you to make a little act of reconciliation, a little gesture of insane hope. Go and buy a field. My time is up. Unity was the prayer on Jesus' lips before he faced the most horrendous situation in his life, because he cared so deeply about it. It's why he died. Unity is not about destroying differences, it's about destroying dividing walls. We need unity and diversity because it's a picture of God himself. It's how he lives. And unity is reclaimed through reconciliation, through the restoration of relationship, and it cannot wait. Do it now. Step out in courage. Take a risk. Every act of reconciliation is an act of obedience. It's a gesture of insane hope. It's a sign of God's coming kingdom. Go and buy a field.
Thank you.
Amazing. I hope you've been able to find space to hear God speak to you through our fourth episode of the series. If you want to journey deeper into this week's message and allow it to shape and grow your faith even more so, we've got some questions to accompany the episode, which you can find in the description or the comments. I'd encourage you to find someone to reflect together with too, or even in community, growing in faith together, supporting and challenging one another in mission and listening to God's Holy Spirit. Get in touch if anything has spoken to you in this episode. You can do that either through the CCS office or even the YouTube comments if you feel comfortable. And if you want to stay connected, there's loads of ways to get involved with what's happening amongst the CCS family. You might want to connect with one of our missional communities, Blessing the Southport community. Again, just contact the office. Or if you want to keep on top of all our news, you can sign up for our weekly email or check out this week's CCS news in the episode description or our social media channels. Speaking of which, remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the notification bell to make sure you never miss an episode of CCS Online. And you can even click the like button so YouTube knows our episodes are worth sharing with others. Hope you join us again in our next episode, and I pray that you have a really blessed week.